Hey everyone, this is Ryan here, and welcome back to our oral surgery series. So far, we've talked about indications and contraindications to tooth extraction, why we would need to perform extractions in the first place. Then we talked about the various instruments utilized for tooth extraction, and now we can finally talk about the exciting topic of performing a tooth extraction, the preparatory steps involved, and then the actual protocol for a routine tooth extraction. In the next video, we'll talk about surgical extractions and the additional steps that come with more difficult and complicated procedures. So there's some preparatory steps we need to take before taking a tooth out. And this may seem silly, but we need to remove the entire correct tooth, because there are serious potential consequences with taking out the wrong tooth, and it does unfortunately happen. So confirm with yourself, with your progress notes, with the patient, and with your assistant to make sure that you're working on the correct tooth. Check the tooth condition. You want to see what you're working with. Are there deep caries where you'll likely crack the crown off? Is there an adjacent restoration or crown that we may potentially damage and need to be careful of? Is this a root tip that we will have to remove some bone in order to access? These are all questions that you should consider beforehand. Check the radiograph. Radiographs are a must. You absolutely need to have a panoramic for third molars and a PA for every tooth you're taking out. It must clearly show the root shape, the root apices, and the surrounding structures. You want to check the proximity of the inferior alveolar nerve in the mandibular and the proximity of the sinus for the maxillary teeth. And this is just because of those complications we talked about in the first video. We need informed consent. Describe alternative treatment options to the patient, including no treatment. Discuss the procedure in layman's terms so they know what to expect, and possible complications like swelling, bleeding, pain, infection, those sorts of things. The patient and provider should both be in comfortable positions. I find that having the patient's mouth at about elbow level is rather comfortable. A more upright chair position is best for lower teeth, and a more reclined position is best for upper teeth. We need profound anesthesia. Of course, this is pretty obvious, but we need to make sure that the patient's comfortable. Blocks are preferred, where we can use those in addition to local injections and even PDL injections as well. And palatal injections are needed for the palate, if you're working on a maxillary tooth, in order to get that palatal, soft, and hard tissue profoundly numb. And lastly, we should use a throat screen. Usually a 4x4 piece of sterile gauze is placed in the patient's mouth to block anything from falling down into their throat, like an extracted tooth. And many clinicians consider this a mandatory step for all cases. All right, so those are the basic preparatory steps for an extraction. Let's talk about the differences briefly between a simple and a surgical extraction. So as far as coding for procedures, there's a distinct difference between simple and surgical extraction. Simple extractions, usually no incisions are needed, and hence no sutures are needed, while surgical extractions typically involve a surgical access via elevating a mucoperiosteal flap. And for flaps, the same rules apply that we talked about in the periodontics videos: a wide base to maintain vasculature, cut to the line angles of teeth, make the flap sufficiently large so you can get good access and visibility. And we'll talk about those in detail in the next video. A surgical handpiece to remove bone or section the tooth. Now, as soon as I pick up a surgical handpiece, it becomes a surgical extraction. So that's really the limiting step and determining when we get to a surgical extraction point. And a suture is usually needed since we had to open up a flap for surgical visibility and access. So again, we'll talk about all these things in much more detail in the next video. Let's focus on simple, uncomplicated extractions in this video. So the first step is to sever the soft tissue attachment. We want to loosen the gingival fibers and the periodontal ligament fibers attached to the tooth. So here we see a periosteal elevator. We talked about this in the last video on instrumentation. This would typically be a Woodson or a number 9 molt periosteal elevator. And so when we're doing this first step, it confirms good anesthesia. It tells you if the patient is profoundly numb. They shouldn't feel anything sharp, but they will feel pressure and pushing, and make sure that the patient understands this before starting. By placing the periosteal elevator and pushing and severing that soft tissue attachment 360 degrees around the tooth, it allows for apical placement of the forceps by severing those fibers and freeing up access to tooth structure, ideally apical to the CEJ. Certainly apical to the clinical crown that we can see, because we want to get as close to the center of resistance, which is at the center of the embedded root, with the forceps. So step number 2 is to luxate that tooth with the dental elevator. So the last step, we use the periosteal elevator. Once we sever as much of those fibers as we can confidently move to this next step. So the face of the dental elevator blade should be placed against the tooth to be extracted. We can see this in the top image and this lower left part of this image. So the face of the blade is against the tooth to be extracted, and the back of the blade, the curved portion, should be against the alveolar crest. So most of these elevators, like the ones we talked about in the previous video, are used as a lever with a fulcrum on the alveolar bone. Now, it's usually inevitable that you will also have some amount of fulcrum on the adjacent tooth, just because of how the anatomy is, especially if there's a tight contact between the two. But you want to avoid luxating or damaging the crown of this tooth unless it too is being extracted. So the idea with the elevator is to find what's called a purchase point, somewhere where you can get between bone and the tooth and feel a good amount of resistance as you slowly twist the elevator in a clockwise or a counterclockwise direction so that the blade is gradually facing occlusally and the tooth moves slightly up and away from the elevator. So you can see how in this image, we're now moving in a counterclockwise direction to get that blade to face occlusally. Now you can move the blade in either direction. Here it's showing clockwise, here it's showing counterclockwise, and you can alternate between those two methods. But whichever way you stick to, this should be done in a very slow and controlled manner, twisting and holding the elevator in a point of resistance for up to 10 seconds. Because what we're doing with this step is expanding the alveolus or the socket of that tooth to allow easy delivery of the entire tooth in the third step. So it can be good practice to support the alveolar ridge with your opposite hand, or support the tuberosity if you're working on an upper third molar, in order to ensure that you're not applying too much force to the ridge. So again, we're causing expansion of bone and continued tearing of the periodontal ligament that's holding that tooth in place. So I find that being slow and deliberate with these first two steps can make an otherwise difficult extraction go very, very smoothly. And now our third step, to deliver the tooth with forceps. And again, here's the key, slow and deliberate. Any forces should be held for several seconds to allow the bone time to expand, instead of just jerking one way and then the next way and then the next way. That's how things tend to break and crack and fracture. So a great concept that I learned in dental school is that the tooth should first be moved and then removed. So all of these steps, 1, 2, and 3, are working towards the same goal. We're breaking the periodontal ligament fibers, and we're expanding the investing bone sufficiently to make the tooth nice and mobile, and then allow the tooth to be delivered from its socket. Again, while you're doing this, your opposite hand might grab the alveolar process to provide tactile information about bone expansion, and also support and stabilize the jaw for lower teeth if you're not using a bite block. So when we're grabbing the tooth with our dental forceps, there are several motions we can do. The outward motion, which is towards the buccal or the labial, is the initial movement for most permanent teeth. An inward or lingual palatal movement is typically the initial movement for most primary teeth. And that's because of the orientation of the roots of most primary teeth. A rotary movement can be used as the initial movement for conical rooted teeth, like upper centrals and lower premolars, for example. And apical pressure should be applied to every tooth with the forceps. You want to grab the tooth as apically as possible, like we mentioned before, to get as close to the center of resistance as possible and to avoid breaking the crown off. But we want to avoid excessive pressure in the maxillary molar region. And that's one of those complications we talked about in the first video, displacement into the maxillary sinus. Now, there's a bit more technique-sensitive method, but you can do a figure eight motion while simultaneously applying apical pressure, and that can be very effective as well. But let's talk about specific teeth and the specific movements you'd make with each one. So, after the periosteal and dental elevators, we want to seat the forceps as apically as possible around the tooth, since we freed up some of those soft tissue attachments that would otherwise be getting in the way of us accessing this. So then we would luxate or move the tooth labially in this direction, and then lingually until it's mobile enough to remove. So we would go labial with some resistance, hold for a few seconds, then push it lingually, hold for a few seconds, and it's slow and deliberate. Nothing is incredibly forceful, but you want to always apply some apical pressure in order to get the tips of these forceps as apically seated as possible. Also, rotary motion can be used because of these conical roots, and that can help to break a lot of the more apically located PDL fibers. And then the tooth can be removed once it's sufficiently mobile. Upper canines, similar concept to the last slide. We want to move the tooth labially, then lingually, then some rotation with apical pressure. But canines have very long roots, and the canine eminence is often adherent to the root, making it more difficult to extract. So it may require a mucoperiosteal flap, and you make a trough around the tooth to avoid removing the entire bony socket. And these are all things we're going to talk about in the next video. How about upper first premolars? So we can move the tooth buccally, hold for a few seconds, then lingual, then buccal, and so on. The difference here is that upper first premolars often have these two roots that don't split until the apical third of the tooth. So these are very easy to crack off, especially if you're applying rotational force. So you might notice we don't have that rotational arrow in this image. And that's because, as a general rule, we do not rotate any teeth that have more than one root. And this is something that we would confirm with that periapical radiograph that we took prior to the extraction. So you can go in knowing that you know what, I'm not going to use rotational force, we're just going to use buccal and lingual force. How about upper second premolars? Now these don't typically have that second root, they can, so again, just be cognizant of that and use those force movements that we've talked about. All right, how about upper molars? So now we're talking about teeth with multiple roots, and so we have to be a little bit more careful, and these are just more difficult by virtue of having more periodontal ligament surface area or volume that is holding the tooth in place. So for the first molar, we want to start with a buccal movement, and notice that it can be a little bit confusing. The previous images, buccal was shown as being to the left, but it's to the right in these photos. So we start with buccal movement and then a lingual or palatal movement, and we want to favor buccal pressure in the upper molars, and that's because the palatal root, which is shown here, may be forced into the sinus if we're not careful and apply excessive palatal pressure and excessive apical pressure. We can end up forcing that long, bulky palatal root into the maxillary sinus. So for upper molars, we tend to focus on buccal pressure and delivering the tooth in a outward buccal direction. All right, so let's talk about the lower teeth. Lower incisors and canines follow a similar concept. The bone is thin on both sides of these teeth, so be careful of breaks. Roots are a little bit less conical and circular than the upper anterior teeth, so use less rotation and more buccolingual movement. And this is also the most common site of crowding, which can make access with the forceps more difficult. Lower premolars. These are probably among the easiest teeth to extract. Rotation is most important due to these very conical, and they tend to be straight single roots. So lower premolars can be very, very nice to extract. And again, we see that rotational arrow here. Now, lower molars are exact opposite. These are among the hardest teeth to extract, since the roots are often divergent and the bone is densest in the posterior mandible. So here we see a mesial view of, or a distal view of, a lower molar, and we're seeing this buccal pressure being applied first and then the lingual pressure, and of course no rotational pressure because we have multiple roots. So these you have to be very slow and steady, again focusing on apical pressure, apical seating of the forceps, and using something like a cow horn forceps in order to engage the bifurcation area. So after the tooth is removed, what can we do after the tooth is removed to promote the best healing of the tooth socket? So remember, we expanded the alveolus as part of our extraction. That was one of our main features and treatment philosophies, was expanding that bone. So it's good practice to squeeze the buccal and lingual cortical plates together with your fingers to facilitate better healing. So you'd want to bend back the bone unless orthodontics or an implant is planned in that area in the future. Bone is flexible to an extent. We don't have to force it, especially if the cortical plates are really thin, but we can bend that bone back just slightly with our fingers in order to make that alveolus a little bit smaller. But we want to avoid doing this if ortho or implant is planned in the future, because smashing the cortical plates together will inevitably cause undesirable cortical anchorage and thinning of the buccolingual dimension of alveolar bone, which is not desirable for implant placement or for future orthodontics if we're going to be moving teeth through that area. Now, after an extraction is done, we have to clean up the scene and do some CSI, or crime scene investigation. So I remember CSI as our acronym here. It stands for curettage, smooth bone, and irrigate. So when curetting, we want to remove residual cysts, radicular cysts, granulation tissue, root and bone debris, whatever might be in that socket, and clean it out. And we do have to be careful about anatomy in the area, like if we have the sinus close by or the inferior alveolar nerve running close by as well. So we get some nice bleeding into the socket and everything is cleaned out. We can also smooth the bone with a bone file or Ronger pliers. So we're talking about bone removers, and this is so we can avoid having really sharp areas on the ridge that can irritate the patient and also make healing a little bit less than pleasant. And lastly, we irrigate the socket to flush everything out. Again, remove any of that bone debris or root debris that was left with some sterile saline and typically a monojet syringe. All right, and that's it for this video. This one was really fun to put together. I think it's a really, really fun topic. And I'm looking forward to the next video on surgical extraction, where we can continue this discussion and just add in a couple more procedures to help with those more complicated extractions. So thank you again for watching. If you're interested in supporting the channel, please check out my Patreon page. A huge thank you to Michael Raja and all of my patrons for their continued support. You can unlock extras like access to these video slides, and you can get some practice questions on there. So go check that out. The link will be in the description. Thanks again for watching, everyone. I'll see you all in the next video.